A scandal in the South Korean Women's Soccer League. 27-year-old Park En-Son of the Seoul City Amazons has now scored 19 goals in just 22 games. However, the other teams are thinking of boycotting Seoul City's next six games because they think the 6-foot, 170-pound Park En-Son may not be a woman.
Oh.
Here was Park En-Son, who denied the accusation.
Isn't that nice? I mean, really, when you really
NBA, oh, I know you can't laugh because your ribs are sore.
Ladies and gentlemen, Imus in the morning.
I've just been informed of Santa coming to my house.
That's right, baby.
All right, hey, Santa coming to my house.
Coming to your house, man.
Good God Almighty, Santa coming to my house.
That's right.
So, coming up this morning, Stuart Varney, Alan Cohen, Bernard McGuick, Guns, and Deirdre Imus on the Mensa meeting. Yeah. And Leif Babin and Jocko what?
Willink.
Willink.
That's right.
Did I pronounce it right?
Yeah, Willink.
Willink.
Yeah, Jocko Willink.
You better pronounce it right.
Or yeah. else.
Well, I'm going to have a talk with Jocko about that last name. It's hard to pronounce for me. So. Then I get these metal blocks.
Yeah, I know.
And then I'll never be able to get it right. So what is it again?
Will ink.
Will ink.
Yeah. It's like a compound word. Will and ink.
Yeah. Santa Claus is here. Rob is late.
What?
Well, where he is.
Oh, he's being naughty, man.
What?
He's being naughty. I just checked my crystal ball. He's being naughty.
Naughty, I just didn't understand you.
Yeah, you know, I got hair in my mouth. Not the first time.
That's fine, Santa.
All right, baby, I'm just, you know.
God.
I wish Tony was were here, but he's not. So.
Yeah, man, you know, I heard him on the show the other day. You know, I got the Santa Cristobal. He said he didn't believe I was black.
Right.
What would he expect me to be? You know, I'm sick and tired.
I think he thinks you're white like a number of other people.
That's very disappointing, man.
Yeah.
Hmm. You know, I'm sick and tired of mythological creatures catching a bad rap.
What?
That's right. Yeah. A lot of us are black. Easter Bunny?
Yeah.
Black.
I did not know that.
Yeah, man. Well, think about it, man.
Okay, well.
Big white bunny wearing a vest, carrying a big basket full of eggs and jelly beans.
Yeah.
In the forest.
Yeah.
You ain't got no camouflage. You ain't never heard of Easter Eagle, have you? No, man, it'd be blood and Easter basket all over the place. That's what I'm saying. He black, man.
That's an angry Santa.
Wow. Oh, why not necessarily a funny Santa, but an angry one.
Wow, huh? Very angry.
Another stereotype. Why the black Santa got to be angry? Why I got to be angry?
Pipe down, Santa.
All right.
Pipe down, Santa.
Was there any game last night we ought to be concerned about, Warner?
Oh, yeah, man. You had the feature game, the Heat.
Oh, the Indiana Pacers and the Miami Heat. Who won that game?
That was a great game. 97-92 Heat.
Hmm. Well, the Heat did win.
Yeah, they were down by 15 in the third quarter, and Mike Breen called the game.
Yeah.
And the game ended on a Paul George tried a three-pointer to tie the game, and it looked like LeBron was grabbing him on the shot, but no foul was called.
I mean, darn.
Shocking.
The outrage.
And the other thing is really humorous with the Knicks game.
Yeah.
Well, they won in double overtime, but at the end of the first overtime, the Knicks led by two, and they got the rebound, offensive rebound, with 14 seconds left. And for some reason, Andrea Bargnani shot up a three-pointer instead of holding the ball. And he missed. The Bucks got the rebound, tied the game, and sent it into the second overtime.
What's the matter with you?
So you got to hear the Knicks announcers, Clyde Frazier and Spiro Dedis. I mean, this is like a clown show.
Yeah.
Oh, and I saw that.
Would that have been a call that the announcer or that the coach would make?
No. A player has to know if there are only 14 seconds left and you have a fresh 24-second clock left and you have a two-point lead, the last thing you want to do is shoot the ball.
Sure. So the player should have already known that.
Oh, yeah, you can't blame that on Woodson.
Okay. Now, Warner went to see Anchorman 2 yesterday.
Yes.
And we'll have a review of that coming up.
Okay.
Let's not blow this now.
No.
Nuh-uh.
Tease.
And, Bernie, what you got?
We have Barbara Walters, Person of the Year, and CNN's big mistake on the lottery ticket winnings, and also the cast of Anchorman on with your friend Jon Stewart. Hilarity ensues.
Okay. Live Mississippi White Boy Pick Feast Dupree.
Morning, boy.
Smell a feast?
Ah, nothing, boy.
You resplendent in red.
Yes, it's the holiday season.
Yeah.
I didn't know Santa was going to be here.
Santa is here.
Merry Christmas, bitches.
Yeah. Merry Christmas, what?
Bitches.
Now, let's do some news now. And here with that is Colin McShane. Morning, Colin.
Hey, good morning, Iman. Well, President Obama's advisory panel's back with some recommendations saying that there should be more oversight of the NSA spying program. So we have that this morning. The panel saying the collection of American phone records should be limited, should be greater scrutiny of decisions to spy on leaders who are friendly to us around the world, all part of the White House conducting an overall intelligence review. President expected to announce some next steps, whatever they may be, in January. And also from Washington, the Senate approved that budget deal, 6436, helps avoid any talk of a government shutdown. Then we have the Mega Millions. One of the winners did come forward, a woman named Ira Curry from Stone Mountain, Georgia. Apparently, she's originally from here in New York, from the Bronx. Not talking to...
Yeah. My homegirl.
That's right. She's not talking to reporters.
Call me.
She did tell lottery officials she realized she won the whole thing here when she heard the numbers being read on the radio.
She said she didn't veer off the road because that was my question. How did you not swerve off the road? She said that she was just in a state of disbelief.
Well, she's going lump sum there. It's $120 million or a little bit more than that after taxes is what she'll get. And she used family birthdays to pick the numbers. That was her secret.
Oh.
Now, speaking of family, her sisters back in the Bronx are telling the Daily News this morning they're going to move, maybe get out of state. They're worried about being in the spotlight.
Right. No, they just want to get out of the Bronx.
They're out. Yeah. So that's kind of funny, right? So the other winners out in California has not come forward. So that's one of the winners. Not a good situation at all for this guy, Iman, from Duck Dynasty, the family patriarch of the show on A&E, suspended indefinitely.
They suspended somebody from Duck Dynasty.
Right.
That's pretty much the end of the world, isn't it?
I would think.
What did he do? What did he say that surprised somebody?
Well, some anti-gay remarks as somebody from GQ magazine asked this
guy. You're kidding. A guy from Duck Dynasty?
Yeah, Phil Robertson.
Some duck hunter from the backwoods?
Yeah.
Wow, what a shock.
They asked him his definition of sinful behavior. And, he said start with homosexual behavior and just morph out from there to things like bestiality, apparently, according to Phil Robertson from Duck Dynasty.
Well,
so he suspended.
It's coming up on 12 after the hour. Time for a little business news sponsored by Short Hills Aviation. And with that, here is Dagan McDowell. Morning, Dagan.
Good morning, sir. The Federal Reserve finally begins pulling back on the AZ money, and the stock market rockets to a new all-time high. You wouldn't think that would happen, but it did. The Dow and the S&P 500 at new records.
What did the Dow end at?
The Dow ended, I can tell you where it, well, there it is. It was up 292 points, 16, 16, 16.
I'm on the radio here. I can't see it.
16,167 and change.
Wow.
292-point gain. Yep, that's right. Central Bank announced it's going to cut back on its monthly bond buying program by $10 billion, bringing it down to $75 billion. That's still a lot of money. But investors see this move as a sign that the U.S. economy is finally on more solid ground.
All right, it is 12 minutes, almost 13 minutes after the hour. Hey, Foot.
Yes.
How are you?
I'm doing really good.
Load up.
Santa
Claus is Black Blues.
Oh. It's there and ready to go.
Okay, well, we're going to do that in a minute with Blind Mississippi. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, Wonderful Sports here at 13 after the hour is sponsored by Short Hills Aviation. Reserve your private jet today. It'd be a good idea to get somebody a private jet. Ought to get Dwight Yoakam one.
Yeah.
Get him a new plane. Find out a Hawker 800. Call 877-880-1836 or go to shorthillsaviation.com. Anyway, good morning, Warner.
Good morning, Iman. So the feature game last night could be a matchup of the Eastern Conference Final. The Heat, down by 15 in the third quarter, came back, beat the Pacers 97-92. Trailing 92-85, Miami went on a 10-0 run. Paul George missed a game-tying three-pointer at the buzzer, but thought he was fouled. Here was the call by Mike Breen of ESPN.
Who will bring it up? Looking for George. George puts up a three. Off the mark. Anderson, the rebound, and that'll do it. Miami with the come-from-behind win. George thought he was hit on that final shot. No whistle, and Miami with a thrilling turnaround here in the fourth quarter to even up the season series between these two rivals.
Well, you should have seen it because LeBron is grabbing him, and there was no foul called. Now,
Where was the game?
The game was in Miami.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah. Mm. Now, Dwayne Wade had 32, LeBron had 24. Yeah. And in double overtime, we just talked about that Knicks game. Talked about a game of losers. The 8-17 Knicks beat the 5-20 Bucks 107-101. A sharp shooting Knicks shot only 37% from the field.
Well.
But here was, listen to this call
now.
By Spiro Dedis and Clyde Frazier of MSG as the Knicks have the game won in the first overtime, but Andrea Bargnani has a brain freeze, and he throws up a three-pointer with a two-point lead and 14 seconds left.
Anthony, one-on-one with Antetokounmpo, shoots over two. Offensive rebound, Chandler to Bargnani. What is he doing? What is he doing, folks? Why would he shoot the ball? Why? The Knicks bench absolutely stunned, and Bargnani, for reasons only known to him, took the three.
You got to see the video of that one, too. I mean, they're going.
Well, you know, you may be unaware of this.
Yes.
Or another, even though that's primarily on the radio all over the world, we are simulcast on the Fox Business Network.
That's right.
So maybe you could show us some video of these things.
Well, we asked for it. That's all we can do.
Oh, and what happened? Bigfoot?
I have no idea.
What happened, Bigfoot?
Well, we didn't roll on the entire game, so we have to get it from a different source.
Oh.
So it's not like an instant thing that we just have it at our disposal.
If you keep it where it is. That's why it's a three-hour show.
That'll be great next hour.
Little tease.
Yeah, maybe we can get it by, say, 10 o'clock this morning.
See Bargnani throwing up a great.
So, yeah.
What else, Warner?
Well, the NFL, this is not a surprise. The NFL has fined Steelers' Terrence Garvin for that blindside hit on the Bengals' punter, Kevin Huber, $25,000, resulting in the broken vertebrae and a broken jaw because he hit a defenseless player with a helmet. And the NFL also criticized the crew for not calling an unsportsmanlike conduct penalty.
Yeah, man, he really laid that guy out. That was horrible.
Oh, man, that was devastating.
Yeah.
It would have nullified the punt return, too, which was a touchdown, might have changed the game.
Yeah, coming up on 17 after the hour, what else?
Well, you remember yesterday the Southern Illinois coach, Barry Hinson? Remember that after he lost to Murray State? He's the guy that chastises players.
Yeah.
Well, here's a bite we didn't get to yesterday.
When you've got a young team, it's a lot like house training a puppy dog. You know what? When the dog does something wrong, bad dog. I'm not going to hit him. I'm not going to swat him, but bad dog. Get on the treadmill.
Yeah. Well, so he was criticized yesterday, but he says, hey, here's his answer to the people who criticize his style.
I stand by, and I believed every word I said. And if that ruffles your feathers or ruffles somebody else's feathers, then you know what? You're going to have to deal with it. But I don't have a speed bump in my mouth, as my wife told me.
Doesn't have a speed
bump. Keeping it real.
I don't think he said anything was out of line, did you?
No.
My
wife could shoot a couple of free throws.
Yeah, I don't think it was necessary to bring his wife in there. I mean,
but it wasn't horrible.
Well, no, he didn't say anything horrible. Not like the guy from Duck Dynasty.
No. Oh,
like,
no.
Come on, dude.
No.
No, not like that.
Yeah.
He's a character.
That's right.
You know, ducks, most animals are bisexual. Are you aware of that?
Warner?
Ducks probably are. There are probably some gay ducks out there. What if he knows that, old fool?
Quack, quack.
Huh.
That whole thing, I've missed the Duck Dynasty craze.
Went right by you.
Yeah, me too.
That is, way too much for me. It's 18 after the hour. Well, Warner went to see Anchorman 2 yesterday, and here he is with his review.
Well, I'll tell you what. It was so stupid that some of the parts were funny.
Yeah.
Which maybe was their plan.
Yeah.
But I'm thinking maybe only people in the business would really get all the nuances.
Yeah.
It was like a satire on the business. Keep in mind, it's 1980, so his Ron Burgundy's wife becomes the first anchor woman in network history. He goes to a 24-hour news operation. They say, well, that'll never happen, obviously.
Yeah.
And he becomes the first announcer ever to put on a car chase on television.
Right.
And people say, well, who's going to watch a car chase?
Yeah.
So it's kind of all satire of the business. That's really it. But I don't think there'll be an Anchorman 3.
Oh, you don't?
No.
Well, that was Will Ferrell. He's pretty good.
Well, yeah, he played that part.
Yeah.
Perfect.
Well, that's all.
You know, I'll tell you what, I've seen a lot of Anchormen in my life, work with them, and he took parts of many of them.
19 FDR. Bernie, what do you got coming up?
We have more from the Anchorman 2, Knuckleheads. CNN's had a bad mistake yesterday, and also this Duck Dynasty guy speaks out.
Robert Earl. Stuart Varney's coming up. We'll find out what's going on with him. You know, whenever my wife is someplace and she runs into people who don't like me, they take it out on her.
Oh, that's odd.
Which I think is kind of nice. She ran into that idiot Eric Bolling.
Oh,
and, I mean, it's not my fault. He's a moron, so.
Well, here we go.
So
this is not going to help
us. But
situation.
She doesn't. She likes him. She doesn't think he's a moron. I do.
Clearly. But this is not going to help now. For Deirdre, if she runs into him again.
Or Melissa Francis. I mean, I can't help it if you know. Oh, there's your mom.
Don't start that. Don't start that again.
Mom's mine. Your mom. Well, anyway, stop being mean to Deirdre. She's about the nicest person on the planet.
Just about, yeah.
You know?
God.
If you have some issue, take it up with me.
Yeah.
It's 29 after the hour. Time for a Bernie briefing sponsored by MyPillow. Here with Adam Bernard McGoik. Good morning, Mr. McGoik.
Good morning, Mr. Imus. Remember the story yesterday? The blind guy with the dog fell on the subway.
Yes.
The dog sort of saved him. Yeah. Well, you know what was going to happen is they were going to take his dog away
right. Because
the dog was aging out. His insurance wouldn't cover him, allowing him to keep it. People donated money, so now he's going to get a new dog and be able to keep the old dog, the old pup. Isn't that beautiful?
Yeah. Oh, that's good.
And here he is. His name is Cecil Williams. Take a listen to him on how grateful he is during this miraculous Christmas season.
Things like this here don't happen for everybody. You know, it should happen. You know, we should care about one another. I'm thinking about God and a few other things. You know, why did he, you know, save me? You know, why did he keep me? You know, I don't know, but I do believe it's for a reason.
Yeah, well, feel good story right there.
Sweet guy, huh?
Yeah, beautiful story. Yeah. Now, Barbara Walters, she named her her most fascinating person of 2013. A lot of suspense out there, a lot of mystery. And it turns out that it is Hillary Clinton. Right, I know. It's very, very anticlimactic. Hillary Clinton is the most fascinating person of 2013 for some bizarre reason. Nobody could figure it out. But listen to Barbara Walters. She gave an interview, and she was talking about President Obama and when he was running for president. Listen to what she thought. Take a listen.
He made so many promises. We thought that he was going to be, I shouldn't say this at Christmas time, but the next Messiah.
You really thought he was going to be the next Messiah. Right. Well, there goes her credibility. Right out the window, boss. And the Anchorman dudes, they were all on with your friend Jon Stewart last night.
Sure.
And, I mean, it's Steve Carell, it's Paul Rudd, it's Will Ferrell and Jon Stewart and some other
Ferrell.
Will Ferrell. Now, take a listen. They show up. They bring him gifts from his green room. They come out. So it's all chaotic. Yeah. And you know hilarity has to ensue. Take a listen. Well, there was a punchline there at the end, but
what was the punchline?
I forget now. It's lost. But we can conclude with that, boss. As the clock ticks on.
Here's my question.
Question.
Or if we have something that is lame and not funny,
it may be to me, maybe. But apparently, people love it.
Who loved it?
I think a lot of people apparently love this Anchorman stuff. They get together.
Oh, no, I understand that. But was there anyone laughing last night at that?
The audience.
They were.
Yes, they were.
Hey, you could hear them screaming.
Yeah.
They were doing backflips.
For some reason.
Play it again. Play the clip again.
All right, here we go. This will be better.
Oh, we got it loaded. Hold on 1 second.
How long does it take to load it?
It's ready.
You got the computer.
It's ready.
All right, here we go.
Oh, here it is.
There you go.
A lot of laughs.
Good times.
So you just do this because you know that I'm a Jon Stewart groupie, and so you do this to hurt me.
What other conclusion?
Try to make him to make him look stupid and lame, which that was. And then, so then that's a reflection on me, because
that sounds a
I'm
little,
always going on about how great he is, which he is, by the way.
Slightly
talking
Captain
from Fox
Quiggish.
News and the Fox Business Network, Stuart Varney. Good morning, Mr. Varney.
Yes, the Fox Business Network. Got it?
So I just noticed on my phone that I have a new Starbucks reward available. Right. I will be getting a free item of food or more coffee with espresso in it, so... You rolled your eyes when I made that pronouncement to my friend over here, Connell McShane.
Yeah.
I've just left the green room, 20 yards that a ways. There are two selections of coffee right there.
Yeah.
Both of them good, both of them free.
I'll stop.
I can't understand why a man like you or Connell would go out and pay big dollars to buy coffee. All coffee contains caffeine. Mm. That's what you drink it for. The caffeine gets you going. You can get it free, 20 yards that away, or you can pay your $4 or whatever it is across the road and send out your associates. What is it? You send out your representatives, is that right? To go get your coffee? Oh. Gotcha.
Gotcha?
Yes, yes.
No, no,
yes.
No, I'm on the air, numbnuts. How can I go get your coffee?
You're the guy who went after me because I had somebody pick up my lost dog.
Yeah, well,
you're the guy who sends an associate to spend big bucks for coffee across the street on a freezing cold morning.
What were you doing that you couldn't go pick the dog up?
Yeah. Working.
No, you weren't.
Yes, I was.
That's your line.
Oh, man, this is 15 love to me at the moment. This is going well. Merry Christmas,
though. Has he got me, Bernie? Is that right?
Yes.
Check on this. I'd say he's got something there.
This is not good. I don't like this.
I like Bernie. He's a good man.
So Barney comes in all torqued off as he ordinarily is.
Always.
Screeching about Prince Charles. What's that all about?
I'm no big fan of Prince Charles.
Why?
He's an uber environmentalist.
Right.
He's often predicting the end of the world, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah. But for once, he's done something right.
Okay.
He has made a public speech, a public announcement, that he wants the hostility and the persecution of Christians in the Middle East to stop. And I respect that, and I admire it, and I think it's time it was said, and he said it. Good stuff.
Well, it's hardly going out on a limb, is it?
For the heir to the throne of England to be involved in that kind of subject, yes, it is going out on.
Oh, it is.
Yeah, they're not supposed to be involved in any political issue whatsoever. You could say that this is kind of political.
How did this come up?
I don't know. I just saw the clip.
Yeah. So Varney also said I complimented him on his show, which I noticed when I get home. And it's on in the kitchen, and most of the time we leave it on. So it's pretty good. But he says, so then he starts to explain to me what he does. And, of course, at that point, I pointed out that was way too much information. And just to say, I say I like your show, just say thank you, and then don't tell me about it. But you did say that you don't waste time talking about Ben Bernanke or any of that stuff. But
we mention him. Yeah. We cover what he's up to. But we're not going to go on at length, ad nauseam, figuring out whether he's going to print less money, when he's going to print less, how much less he's going to print. We don't spend a lot of time doing that.
Isn't he leaving or something?
Yes, he's leaving.
Okay.
End of the year. Janet Yellen takes over next year.
Are you happy with her?
I'm neither one way nor the other. She's
going
to do exactly what Ben Bernanke's been doing for the past 4 or 5 years.
Oh, she is?
Yeah. She's going to print some money where she thinks it's necessary. Right. She'll continue the policy of stimulus via printing money.
Well, a bunch of people around the Fox Business Network, which you think you would be on board, were in a lather over his final pronouncement, Mr. Bernanke. So.
Yeah. Well, what he said was he'll print a bit less money next month. Investors loved it, and the Dow went straight up nearly 300 points, new record high. So
what does that mean? I don't understand what all that means. You're going to print less money.
Okay.
How does that affect me?
Okay. He uses the Federal Reserve, which is the only institution allowed to actually print money, okay? He prints $85 billion a month, and with that money, he buys treasury bonds and he buys mortgages. That pushes interest rates way down. So, if you go and put your money into a bond or a bank CD, you get virtually no return because interest rates are at near zero.
Yeah.
It's not worth it. So, what do you do with your money? You want a decent rate of return, you go straight to the stock market. So, when Ben prints up a storm, interest rates come down and stocks go straight up. That's what happened.
Okay. Well, that's good then, isn't it?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Theoretically,
yeah. You print all this money, and sooner or later, you have rampant inflation. But it hasn't happened yet. They've printed $4 trillion, and we've got zero inflation, if you look at the government numbers. No. So the theory is wrong, and the effect is very beneficial to a lot of investors.
Talking with Stuart Varney here in the IBIS Morning Program. Do you have a Christmas tree in your house?
We do.
Did you help decorate it?
Yes, I bought it, set it up. It fell down. I put it up again, straightened it out. The family decorated it.
And then you fell down.
Hang anything on it.
Yes. The star at the top of the tree,
okay.
Which broke when it fell down.
Oh.
Man.
God.
Now.
Why are you leaving this subject so quickly? I thought you'd feast on my putting up a tree that falls down.
Oh, no, I'm not surprised.
May I have a little more punch, please?
So do you, do you wait up for Santa? What do you leave Santa?
What do I leave Santa?
Yeah. Do you leave a little snack of some kind?
In the old days, when the children were young, yes, it would be cookies and milk. These days, we leave nothing.
Oh.
We open presents on Christmas Eve morning.
What does that mean?
The morning of Christmas Eve, which will be next Tuesday morning.
Why wouldn't you wait until Christmas?
What does it mean?
Well, I know what it means. Numbnuts.
I apologize.
I meant...
Can you elaborate on that?
You're losing today. You really are losing. I've gotten clobbered today.
That's what happened. Why wouldn't you wait till Christmas?
Christmas Eve is the day before Christmas
I know what day. It is.
All day.
What does it mean?
It's December 24th.
Why would you open them then? Why not wait till Santa comes?
Desperate to change the subject.
He doesn't come until Christmas Eve night.
It's true.
You got me.
Okay, well, then why?
You must pass over.
I don't know where to go with this. I'm totally stumped. Okay.
I hope your tree blows up. And how about your turkey?
Yes.
Oh, that blows up too. So.
Oh, really? Well, Merry Christmas to you.
Yeah, the same to you.
Just because you didn't know that Christmas Eve is a 24-hour affair and it's December 24th. Thank you very much.
Hey, Stuart Varney here in the IBIS. Well, I don't think we need to be calling Stuart names, Bernie. No. Stuart Varney here in the IBIS. And the Mensa meeting is coming up next hour, and that's with Alan Combs and Dan Ives and Guns and. But now I'm great.
Mm-hmm.
That could be good because we have, it will be good because we have good topics. We will not be discussing vitamins, though, I guess.
Oh, man.
And that was ugly yesterday, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm. Look out.
So, and then, I love Varney, don't you? But that's, one of these days we will find, be on the front page of the Post.
Yeah.
Found naked out in the woods.
Oh, man.
Tied to a tree. Don't you think, Bernie?
Wearing, jack boots and stuff.
Yeah. With a leather mask on.
Merry Christmas.
So.
Ooh.
And those sandals of his that he wears with his white socks.
With the socks, sure.
Officer, you got me. Put the cuffs on.
So later on this morning, Leif Babin and his partner, Jocko Willink.
What?
Well, however you pronounce his name. How is it?
No, Willink. You
Willink.
Got it. You got it. Sure.
5 till the hour.
All right. I miss
in the morning. What are you doing with Santa?
I'm fixing his hair.
Oh.
Okay.
My stylist. I've known Blind for a long time.
What?
I've known Blind for a long time.
Go way back.
Mm-hmm. How far back do you go?
New Orleans. 23.
Yeah. The first time a levee broke.
That's right. All that water had to go somewhere.
Whatever he says, you just laugh, whether it's funny or not.
Oh, no, some of this stuff is funny. Trust us, we understand what we're doing.
No, I was thinking how he was quoting a Richard Pryor thing. Yesterday, when we were trying to find the phrase for Deirdre from the Mudbone Miss Rudolph bit, we pulled it up on YouTube. Man, does that hold up. Just, it's uncanny how...
Little tiny baby feet.
Really brilliant his characterizations were. And
I know.
Sharon got me this box set last year for Christmas of all the movies, all the In Concert movies, and all the album CDs. and you watch and you listen and you just, you, there was nobody like him. He and Carlin were just like law, you know. But just, it's still funny, no matter how many times I've seen it.
Well, you know? Wyatt is a huge fan of George Carlin.
Absolutely. Yeah. That's the thing, you know. It's like one of my first bonding experiences with my father was over AM/FM. We were both laughing at the same thing, you know.
I'll be darned. I like these.
No, I'm just. Oh,
anecdotes from your.
Ladies and gentlemen, Imus in the morning.
So, Robert Andrews and Vinnie Andrews, the Andrews Brothers management, the financial management office, have handled my finances for over 40 years. I met them through Michael Lynn, and they've been fabulous. And two of my best friends, you know, part members of the family.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm a very conservative investor. So, and, you know, I think that these are two of the sharpest guys on the planet.
Yeah,
right.
So I get an email from Robert yesterday. He says, here's an eye-opener. And it's somebody had sent it to him. And it's a graphic of Clint Eastwood and the president talking to each other. And first there's a shot of Clint. And he says to the president, I hear you spent $678 million on the Obamacare website. Really? And the president says, that number has been greatly exaggerated by the right wing. And Clint says, sure it is. So how many citizens is this plan intended to cover? And the president says, all 315 million in all 57 states.
Aha. Mm-hmm. You get it?
So then Clint says, so you're telling me that instead of building this site, you could have just given each of us $2 million.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay.
The problem is, it's not $2 million, Robert.
Mm-mm.
It's $2.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they manage your money, huh?
Well, me, we got to have a meeting. This morning.
Now.
In fact, I could get my ass out of here now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Robert.
Like, you know, 40 years ago, Robert says to me, or Vinny, one of them.
Yeah.
They said, well, they handle a lot of people. Well, famous people. They're good. They're wonderful ones. He said, well, so all of the bills and stuff go to them, and then they cut the checks. And he said, we sign a lot of our clients' checks so they don't have to be bothered. I said, you're not going to sign mine. And he says, why? I said, because I don't trust you.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I still don't trust him. So,
good thing.
Well, I don't mean that in a bad way. I mean, I don't trust anybody. So.
Nobody.
So you got 2 million reasons.
That's true.
I got 2 million reasons.
Nah, don't invest in Microsoft. That company ain't going nowhere.
Well, though I did, in fairness to Robert, I did get an email from him this morning. Acknowledging that he had made this error. So. Thank God.
Mm-hmm.
Sounds better. Like Clint wasn't that good at math either.
Santa Claus is here. Santa, how you doing, baby?
Hey, baby, how you doing?
You know, we got news, right?
Of course, yeah, tons of it.
What is? What, give me the. What's a big?
Well, it's a big Target credit card and fraud investigation over Target. That's.
I don't care anymore.
You got.
We'll get to that in a minute.
Rodman?
Calm down.
Oh man, come on.
Marcus over 16,000, right?
Yeah. Yep. Okay. Hot dog.
And
what? Adogin.
That'll be fine, Warner. And the Heat beat the Pacers last night, right?
Yeah, man. They were down by 15 in the third quarter.
That. Yeah. So we'll get to all that. The Mets meeting coming up. And then Leif Babin and his partner, Jocko Willink,
mm-hmm.
are coming over. I have troubles with L's. So I hope Jocko cut me some slack on that, both Navy SEALs.
If there is one man on the planet who you want to pronounce his name right, it would be that dude. Wait till you see him in person. He is, well, threatening looking.
Well, don't make me have to go upside his head when he gets
that's
there.
That's right. I'm out. Take him out.
I was in the Marine Corps. I hit him with my bugle.
Look out, Chucko. Hit him with your bugle.
Blind Miss Liberty, White Boy, Pig Feast Dupree. Got a song about Santa. Santa, you're going to like this.
Yes, yeah, we got a lot of songs about me.
Okay, let's hear do this it.
One. Well, it was late last Christmas Eve, and I was getting ready to hit the sack. When I saw something I couldn't believe, boy, I tell you, I damn near had a heart attack. St. Nick done come down my chimney, and imagine my surprise to find out the old Santa Claus was black. He wore a big red Kango, FUBU leather bag across his back. With bells that jingle jangle, you'd think I was hallucinating smoking crack. But I swear Kris Kringle looked just like Charles Rango. In that red fur suit, he was big peeping like the Mac. Santa Claus called upon his reindeer, left me in somewhat of a quandary. On Latasha, Moesha, Lawanda, on Jasmine, Donella, DeAndre. Well, soon they all will be a-flying right to your house straight from the North Pole. And Santa's Christmas cheer he will be supplying with a joyful and resounding ho, ho, ho. There will be no more denying Santa Claus is one fat and jolly player who remind you of CeeLo.
Stop.
Yeah.
That was awful.
That was brutal. Tear to mind.
Brutal.
All right.
Play it, baby.
I'll never again disparage a Conan O'Brien clip after that.
Oh. Yeah.
Time for the news now. And here with that at 11 minutes after the hour.
Yeah.
This is Conal McShane. Morning, Conal.
Morning, I-Man. This credit card fraud investigation at Target, while the Secret Service is in on it and leading the investigation, as many as 40,000 card readers at Target stores said to have transmitted information, potentially millions of cards, and the information transmitted to counterfeiters.
What are you going
to
tell me? Because Tony laughed?
We all laughed.
Yeah, man.
Well, they're just trying to make you feel good.
No.
Yeah, that's it.
so they do like we
do that.
No, that was funny, man.
It's a good one.
Did you hear Lou laughing?
Lou was laughing.
Yeah, I laughed.
You laughed?
I heard Lou laughing.
I laughed.
Well, that's because people like you. So, I mean, I love you, so.
Maybe.
I love you, and I wasn't laughing, but.
It's all right.
It's a direct reflection on me whenever we do something. It's just.
Yeah, we all just get along.
What were you talking about now?
This credit card thing at Target. They're investigating it. And bottom line, customers shouldn't lose money over it, but we'll probably have to get new cards. We'll get more on that later. But how about this? The Russian
press... Why don't you have any definitive information?
No, it's an investigation that's underway.
Well, no,
40 million. 40 million cards compromised. There you go. Boom. Drop the mic.
Already said that.
Well, why are you just trying to scare us then?
Boom.
Right.
What are we supposed to do with this information you're not giving us?
Well, do you go to Target?
No, I don't.
Doesn't affect you that much then. So, Russian President Vladimir Putin.
Well, doesn't mean anything. I may have some friends of mine go to Target.
Friends?
Well, I don't know. Some of the folks at the ranch go to.
For example, yeah. Well, they heard the information.
My peeps go to Target.
And they'll continue to follow the developments and see if they have to get a new card, that might be what happens to them. They get a new credit card if their information's been compromised.
Have you heard from Charles Lou?
Actually, I.
I didn't get a Christmas card from him, nothing.
God.
Have you heard from him, Warner?
No.
No.
Okay, well.
Then you're stuck.
Stuck with you, then.
You're stuck. Exactly right.
What else?
Russian President Vladimir Putin is coming to the defense of the NSA's surveillance program. So there's a defender you want. He had a news conference over in Moscow. Putin says mass surveillance is needed to fight terrorism and expose terrorist contacts.
Oh, sure.
Now, speaking of Russia, I-Man, could be a very, very big day over there.
Start the Pussy Riot!
That's right. Members of the punk band Pussy Riot could be set free today.
All right.
How about that? Now, the state-run news agency is reporting there's some sort of amnesty bill working its way through the Russian legislature, and bottom line, could have an effect on thousands of non-violent prisoners in Russia, as well as those on trial. Could include the members of the band Pussy Riot. They might get out of jail today.
So. This is really a highlight of your career, isn't it?
Absolutely. Yeah.
I love it when he's talking hairdo news anchors.
Talking hairdo?
Yeah.
Oh, no.
Sitting there with a stick in her butt. Get
now
to
Connell's
say
outraged.
Pussy Riot.
Multiple times. I said it like three or four times.
All right, time for some business news, sponsored by
Pussy Riot.
Short Hills Aviation. Here with that is Dagan McDowell. Morning, Dagan.
Good morning, sir. The futures are down just slightly this morning, but we've got new records for the Dow and the S&P 500. Federal Reserve Reserve finally pulling back on that bond buying program. But again, if the economy is more stable, that's good news. And then you'll enjoy this. Whole Foods will stop selling Chobani yogurt early next year. The supermarket chain wants to make room for brands that are organic and do not contain genetically modified ingredients. Bad news for Chobani, founded just 6 years ago, $1 billion in annual retail sales. But good news for the likes of, say, Stonyfield.
Pussy
there you
Ryan.
Go.
Pussy Riot.
I think that's the kind of yogurt I'm into, is that Stonyfield. So.
Yep.
This portion of the Ice Morning Program is sponsored by Sunrise Volkswagen, the number one Volkswagen dealer in the Northeast. Go to sunrisevolkswagen.com. Time for sports. You know, Warner, I don't know who sports is sponsored by. So.
Well,
anybody you'd like to give it to?
Yeah, we got Peter Morgan right here in the studio.
Great then let's
Morgan.
Give it to Payless Boilers.
Yes.
So sponsored by Payless Boilers, and here with that is Warner Wolf. Morning, Warner.
Morning, I-Man. NBA, the feature game last night. The Heat, down by 15 points in the third quarter, came back, beat the Pacers 97-92. Trailing 92-85, Miami went on a 10-0 run, including this big three-pointer by Ray Allen, with 59 seconds left. Called by Mike Inglis of WAXY Miami.
Three in the shot clock. George throws it up. Missing. Rebound. Into the hands of LeBron. James on the run. A three-on-two break. Allen for three. Count them all! Ray Allen from downtown. Back-to-back threes by Miami. And it's the first lead since the first quarter. Thank you.
Thank you. Paul George missed a game-tying three-pointer at the buzzer and thought he was fouled by LeBron. LeBron at 24, Wade at 32. The Ravens are 2.5-point favorite over the Patriots in Baltimore on Sunday. Now, here was a double-talking Bill Belichick when asked about the difference in the Ravens' personnel since the last time they played in the AFC title game.
They're a team that we're familiar with, but there are a lot of changes from the last time we played them. We're certainly familiar with it, but it's different, and we're different, so it's the same, but it's different.
Oh, okay.
Oh. Professor Irwin Corey. In case, by the way, there is a blizzard called for the Super Bowl Sunday, February 2nd, here in New York, the NFL announced the game could be moved to either Saturday night, February 1st, or Monday night, February 3rd, which they already exist emergency plans for every Super Bowl they do that. And not everybody wants to play for the Yankees. Reds free agent right fielder Shin Soo Chu has turned down the Yankees' offer of $140 million, 7 years, average of $20 million per year. I mean, here's a guy in 9 years, his lifetime batting average, .285. He averages 20 homers and 81 RBIs.
Yeah.
You remember Chu's brother.
Sure. Ach. This is not funny, Warner.
No, at all.
And on his and Rob this morning, guys are killing me.
And on his weekly radio show, Cowboys owner Jerry Jones was asked about Tony Romo's two late fourth quarter interceptions against Green Bay.
Aggressiveness with Romo can mean him not throw the ball but buy more time, which increases the chances of having a bad play. All of a sudden, you're into a little more sandlot type football.
Uh-huh.
He has lost his mind. Really, hasn't he?
Well, I was hoping he would call in, but, you know, he usually does after his... But I guess he's not interested this
morning. He's not going to be your monkey jumping through your hoop today, riding a little tricycle. What else? Come on, hurry up.
Finally, here it is. Over the last 20 years, you always talk about charities, and some of them are a little bogus. The PGA... Professional Golfers Association, yeah, has saved themselves over $200 million in charitable tax deductions when they hold what is referred to as a non-profit golf tournament, raising money for charity. Yeah. However, a closer look by the charity watchdogs shows that, for example, the money raised in 2011, only 16% went to charity. Anything less than 65% going to charity is deemed irresponsible. So, I mean...
Yeah, duh. 19 after the hour. Bernie's on his way over. The Mets are meeting.
Good morning, Connell. Good morning, Mr. Imus. And, you know, the big story of the morning, of course, this Duck Dynasty dude getting suspended from A&E for his remarks to a GQ magazine. One of his quotes, anti-gay statements is what he actually made. Quote, it seems like to me the word that rhymes with angina right. would be more desirable than a man's, you know what. Oh, and he says, that's just me. I'm just thinking there's more there. She's got more to offer. I mean, come on, dudes. That's his first mistake, though, implying that it's a choice and not something that they're born with. And then he goes on to liken it to bestiality, and people are complaining, free speech, blah, blah, blah. Jeez. Let's move on to Christina Applegate, something more pleasant.
Yeah.
She was on last night with Jay Leno describing that whole era back that the movie is based on, Anchorman 2. She's one of the co-stars. She plays Ron Burgundy's ex-wife in the movie. Take a listen to Christina Applegate from last night on Jay Leno.
It takes on the advent of 24-hour news.
Right.
Because there
right.
was a time when you would turn on the TV at 5 o'clock, you'd have news from 5 to 6.
And you'd get real news.
You'd get news. You'd right. get hard news from right. 5 to 6, and that was it. And now you can turn on the TV at any time, and, like, you know, they're showing Nelson Mandela's funeral, right. and then the ticker's going, like, you know, Kim Kardashian had a side boob incident right. on right. the bottom, right. and then you've got, like, the Dow thing over here, and it's right. like, right. So we kind of take that on.
This is a pure era.
Yes.
Anytime you get Kelly Bundy talking about side boob, right. I mean, it's ratings gold. That's what I'm saying. She's nowadays a mom I'd like to friend on right. Facebook, the beautiful Christina Applegate.
What was the I'm glad I missed the Duck Dynasty thing.
Yeah.
Do you ever watch that?
I never really have, to be honest.
Me either.
No. I mean, it's just so much on TV. Carly loves it. A lot of people love it.
What do they do? What do they do?
I have no idea.
Yeah, what do they do? Do you know, Dagan?
Yes, they make duck calls for a living. Wow. What do you mean, what do they do? They're a family. I mean,
that's what I mean. What do they do?
What but happens on the show?
It's a reality show like the Kardashians.
It's a family from Louisiana. They have this business that they started, have been incredibly successful. They're funny, earthy. Themselves committed to God, family, and country.
There oh, sounds like it.
No wonder we missed it.
Well, that's what he was actually paraphrasing the Bible. Was this gentleman, Mr. Phil Robertson?
What?
He talked about how his life in the 60s was sex, drugs, and rock and roll. He accepted Jesus, and today his mission is to go forth and tell people why he follows Christ.
Oh, man.
And
his brother, Cy, has a book that's on the bestseller list.
Well, wrestlers. I've had New York Times number one bestsellers. So.
Writing about what?
But it's still quite the phenomenon.
Why am I not surprised that Dagan is into this?
Oh, she's all into it, sure. Well, she's related to them.
It's one of the top shows.
Well, that doesn't mean anything. Well, it's a top anything. What does that have to do with it?
Yeah, have some taste.
Well, she's on the cutting edge. That's what it has to do. She knows what time it is.
We need to put her back in her trailer with her and put a tire on top of it.
Family people, making duck calls.
People are outraged that this guy was suspended, by the way. Oh, but, this really? Is free speech. Yes, they are. A lot of people are. Believe it or not. It's not, they're just saying, look, that's his belief. That's what
he
believes.
Well, is he aware that all animals are, most animals are bisexual?
I don't know if he's aware of that.
Probably some gay ducks, ugly words from my wife.
Follow-up question. This is unbelievable.
Anyways, what if they have a gay duck?
I can't believe
call,
the way you two
know?
Talk to each other.
I said to Alan, that's nothing. You need to hang around. She'll really see some.
If you ever taped this, you'd have a case. You'd have a legal case.
Oh, there'd be something, all right.
Time for the Mensa Meeting with Guns, Deirdre, Alan Collins, and Benaim Mingoyuk. And let's start with what you had during the Bernie briefing, something about the Duck Dynasty guy?
Yes, sir. The patron of the Duck Dynasty empire, this guy Phil Robertson, he was giving an interview to GQ, and they asked him. They're religious, you know. They're Christians, and
sure.
They asked him about his position on homosexual marriage and stuff, and he said, "quote It seems like to me a vagina as a man would be more desirable than a man's what rhymes with Seamus." And then he says, that's just me.
Let me try to figure it out. Okay, yeah, I got it.
You got? Yeah, he says, that's just me. He doesn't understand it. It's illogical, but sin is illogical, according to him. And he went on to paraphrase the Bible, and he spoke out, and he said that he used to be into sex, drugs, rock and roll, but now his mission is to tell people about why he follows Christ. He says everybody should be treated with respect.
Right.
And he was suspended.
Who suspended him?
A&E. A&E suspended him from future filming. They're going to go ahead with this series starting, say, in January when it picks up again. Sure. They already have an episode in the can or a series in the can.
What?
No pun intended, by the way.
What did A&E think? What did A&E think they had? What did they
right,
think?
They got exactly. some bearded backwoods duck hunter. I mean, what did they yeah. think they had? No. You know, some...
I mean, he's living literally the stereotype of what you would think. He unfortunately yeah. he played the whole stereotype out.
Right, it's yeah. not Dick
and so people are outraged at A&E.
Oh yeah, I went to the A&E Facebook page today. They are getting hated on, and there's already over a million people on this new Facebook group saying they refuse to watch it unless they bring this guy back.
Yeah. And I always find
over a million people in one day.
I didn't know that part of Christianity was homophobia.
I know, well, right? It's not.
You could say that's almost it's not homophobia. It's a religious tenet. It's a teaching that homosexuality is a sin. It's the same. You're exhibiting some religious bigotry.
Oh, I am.
It's
huh?
like what happened.
I'm the one exhibiting
it's like,
bigotry. Yeah,
it's like what happened.
I point out that between I'm the
it's
bigot.
Like what
okay, great.
Tim Tebow, people knew he was
I'm the bigot.
Of course, Bernie's
right,
exactly. the one that defends all the priests as well. So I mean, what do we really have there?
Alan, what does your rabbi say about homosexuality?
I do not speak for rabbis.
No,
but I'm not the super
listen,
Jew.
No, does a rabbi? Do you know any rabbi? And what their
I
point
do
of
know
view
a rabbi or two. Yes.
On homosexuality.
It depends on whether you're Orthodox, conservative, or Reform. I happen to be a Reform Jew.
Because this duck hunter gentleman, he's also a reformed drug addict, sex addict, what, all this stuff he did. And so they're the worst kind because then they reform themselves and all of a sudden they found Jesus and they think they know everything and they're trying to tell everybody else their interpretation.
Jesus wouldn't say this stuff.
But
I
disagree with this guy. He's implying that homosexuality is a choice, at least with guys.
Yeah.
And there's no way. I mean, if you have
ignorant.
If you have some guy like Carly versus
ignorant.
Guns, you're not going to choose guns. I mean, it's just
right.
You have to be wired that way.
I mean, yeah. yeah.
That's true.
In fact, I can't say you wouldn't choose well, even if you liked
me. But the more, I guess, maybe he will learn
the
now.
Hypocrisy is stunning. And not surprising, though, with A&E. I mean, they obviously knew what
yeah,
they had.
Exactly.
Right. Idiots. You know, and plus it's free
right, speaking of the clergy, a record number of people in the United States have expressed a lack of trust in clergy members, not just priests, because, as you know, they got their hands all over the kids. And rabbis, too, by the way. We had a few rabbis.
Why are you looking at me?
I mean,
these are your people.
I'm looking at you because you're a Jew. That's
so
why
I'm
looking
responsible
at you.
For
I'm looking at
there?
Him because he's a Catholic. I'm looking at these two okay. because they're...
We're Catholic, yeah.
Yeah,
something like
Deirdre's
that.
A Catholic. And Guns is... what are you, Guns?
That's what she is.
Yeah, well, she, yeah okay.
What are she
that's
is?
That's why I'm looking at you. Why is that?
I don't speak for them.
Well, I don't know. No,
I'm not their spokesperson.
The question is, why do less people trust the clergy?
Yes. Right.
Tell us, Bernie, why?
Well, I trust the clergy. I mean, I think
they're
devoted people. I have a lot of respect for them. I don't paint them all with this broad brush that sometimes some people that I know try to paint them with. I respect and trust them and go to them for advice. And
I think fewer people trust clergy because of what we've seen and. I even had my own experiences where I trust them less.
What happened?
Well, I remember a priest hitting on my mother when we were going to church. And we stopped going to that church, going back to 7th and 8th grade.
Do you know how many priests and...
A priest hitting on your mother?
Oh, yeah.
It's better than a kid, though.
He was very flirtatious
with
my mother.
Is the first time you've heard this?
Well, your mother's a pretty good-looking woman.
But that's a single... You have nuns and priests ministering to AIDS patients and the poor. And so you can't just dispel the whole group because of an incident. Your mother got hit on by a priest.
What about a great role model the Pope is? Current Pope is fantastic.
Anyway, that takes
no, but because of the pedophilia, I mean, that is a big, it's a huge problem, and you can't ignore it. And I know you like to brush it over not really there.
No.
It is there.
People like to over-sensationalize it. As a percentage of the population, there's no more pedophilia occurring in religious institutions than there are, say, in the teaching
institution. He loves defending priests.
Right. Well, are you kidding?
New people are haters.
They're called out when they're teachers. In the clergy, they just get moved quietly to another church or somewhere else in another country.
What the hell happened
to
you?
They do not take care of it and get rid of these priests.
You got to stop talking when I'm talking because then it sounds, then you can't understand what's going on. It's like at home.
You know what, Alan just asked me before? He says, are you going away? And I said, we're going to Texas. He goes, oh, does your husband go with you?
Why is that funny? I don't expect he goes anywhere without, I don't know why that's funny.
New Harris poll finds.
Has this been an issue that I'm not aware of?
74% of U.S. adults believe in God. 74% of people in this country believe in God. That's down from 82%. So what happened to cause a drop of 8%?
I think the world just falling apart more and more, and people are going through tougher times and realizing that.
I think you're a sucker to buy into those statistics. Some of this is just, where are they coming up with it? And it's such a small margin there.
Well, let's not argue with my facts here.
Numbers are
another
question.
I'm not going to totally buy into
that. He's a numbers
man
right here.
I feel like I'm in Sunday school. What the hell?
I know. Come on.
72% believe in miracles. Do you?
Sure.
Hey,
I do.
I look at the two of you with 19 years.
Yeah,
and I'm right here.
Yeah. 19 years.
We are a miracle. Yes. Sure.
All right, 17 to Leah here on the Adam Simoian program. Except for you, Alan. Do you leave anything out for Santa? Do you?
Yeah, milk and cookies, you know. Yeah, still.
Do you? What do you
I mean, so typical. Milk and cookies.
Yeah, well, what's wrong with that?
Salad.
No, what?
Veggie salad or veggie juice.
You know, you can suck the joy out of even Christmas.
But how is that? How even many milk and cookies does Santa need?
No, but I mean,
salad.
He loves it, and he loves salad.
Salad for Santa.
With walnuts and cranberries in it. Oh, yeah. With all the baby greens.
That's why he's not coming to your house.
Well, and have any of you ever met Santa?
I have.
You have?
That's right.
Hi, Santa.
I was part of Santa Con this past.
Good to see you again.
Santa's here with us this morning. Santa, how are you?
I'm good. It was happening.
Okay. Well, not a lot, Santa, but except for you, Alan.
Oh, I say leave the Jew out.
Well, no, but so anything you'd like to ask Santa for, Bernie?
Yeah.
Some
forgiveness? Oh, no, you're not God. You're Santa Claus. No, Santa's scared.
I get confused.
I have to tell you.
Just don't
hit me. How about that?
You know, I play the knockout game every now and again.
God,
they never see it coming.
Two words, two syllables, something I need for Christmas. His wife. Yes. How you doing? Yes.
Well.
Can you make that happen? Or
you know, my crystal ball.
You know what the big mistake is? Me thinking that having Tony come out as Santa and talk to you guys would be funny. That's a huge mistake here.
Okay, we can just have the spirit of Santa Claus sitting there then.
All right, here now, topic number three. A Utah district court ruling has found key parts of Utah's prohibition of polygamy unconstitutional, setting a new legal precedent that effectively decriminalizes the practice. In other words, they've decided it's okay to have more than one wife. What do you think?
Why do I care how many people marry? Fine. Whatever consenting adults do is their business.
Okay.
At least he's consistent. That was some of the argument against gay marriage. Once you legalize that, it's a slippery slope. But listen, I think having more than one wife is stupid, but it's a free country. Yeah. If you want to, go right ahead and hang yourself.
If you've got one bitching at you 24 hours a day, why would you need two of them?
Exactly. I mean, right.
Then it becomes a Mormon tabernacle choir.
Right. That's not so.
Telling you to pick your stuff up.
I mean, Alan, what do you care about? You're just like, whatever everyone does.
Why do you
does,
even sit here and let him get away with that?
Because
why do you let him?
Because he doesn't really mean it. I know him. I've been with him 21
years. Did you hear what
he
just said about
women?
Biatches?
What's your view on this?
I know your heart. So.
What is your view on
that? It's wrong. You marry, you have one wife, or you have one husband. That's it.
I'd say get as much tail as possible.
Why do you need more?
That's the gun.
Yeah, why do you need more than one wife?
You don't have
wife?
To marry it. That's the difference.
Yeah. All right, which leads us to this. The affair dating website Ashley Madison. You guys heard of this?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes.
Their slogan is "Life is short, have an affair."
Been there, done that.
has released the list of the 10 most adulterous cities in the nation, according to their membership. Washington D.C. is number one. It's not surprising, is it?
This is a poll simply for the purpose of getting this website attention. That's all. They make it up. Who knows? How do you know what city has the most affairs? Who knows that? How do you find that out?
Have you ever had an affair?
No.
It may be their business.
So now you're defending the politicians in D.C.
Yeah, right.
It may be how it impacts on their business. That's all.
But what Alan said is true. It is just a publicity stunt. However, the Washington, again, politics is Hollywood for ugly people. So the idea that John Boehner is getting busy with good. Nancy what's-her-name Schultz or Mitch McConnell is shacking up with Nancy Pelosi, it's pretty revolting.
Yeah.
But yeah. But no, they screw in the rest of the country. Why not screw each other down there?
Or tanning with John Boehner. I read something the other day where it said that he's renting his place from one of the lobbyists for the Tanning Association.
Oh, I mean,
Yes, I heard about it. Yes,
that's crazy.
Yeah,
he's a nut.
Hey, look, the guy, he like wants to look good.
So you really, for this Mensa meeting, none of these topics are any good at all, are they?
The polygamy one.
Thanks, thanks for your help.
Sorry,
for the most part, the whole thing.
You know what?
You
know what you're getting this year for Christmas? Oxygen holes with a kink in it. How about that?
How's he doing?
That's our kind of Santa. That is very hurtful, Santa.
Yeah, come on, Santa.
That's not how we
do. So now what do we do?
Yeah, go home.
Try to recover. Holy God. Well, it's my fault. So.
Oh. Hank Aaron never hit a home run every time up.
Not every time.
Always remember that.
Write that down.
755 times.
Yeah.
Man, that's fouling one off.
Yeah,
and hitting some bold lady there in the third base.
Just a bit outside.
Hitting an old lady in a wheelchair. That's what that is. Oh, man.
An old lady widow in a wheelchair.
God, come on, man. Imus. Imus. Imus in the morning. An old blind lady in a wheelchair. Why would she be at the game? Hi, man. Oh, man. What's the temperature?
31 or so. Let me see. Something like that. Low 30s.
Well, that's fine. I just...
33.
Okay. So that's...
Oh, man.
Why did you ask me if I wanted a big coffee?
Because you can get any kind, right? With the reward?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So I figured it would save you some.
Well, first of all, I only drink about 2 sips out of it.
Yeah, I know.
And then it gets cold.
Oh, right.
You mean just a screw Starbucks?
Yeah, get a little more bang for your buck.
No, I'm not into that.
Okay. Thing. That's fine. Do you want anything to eat?
What could I get, though, that would put a dent in them? A little dent. Make him think maybe we shouldn't have done this.
I don't know. What do they cover?
Well, it covers anything you want.
Any drink, yeah.
Any drink?
Mm-hmm.
Well.
Well, what's the most expensive drink then?
I don't know.
Just say, give me your most expensive drink.
What?
Yeah, but it's got all that
you're not
sugar and stuff in it that I don't like.
Yeah,
so.
All that crap. You're not
syrup.
I want some espresso.
There is it, the lava.
Well, just go get that, Carly. Many please. Expensive.
What? A black eye? Regular. What you always get.
Yes.
Okay.
Good talk.
Well, why am I getting irritable?
I don't
about
know.
Everything.
What's that about?
It's like, I feel like
she just asked me, and I get irritable.
Sometimes around the holidays, people get
a little upset.
Imus in the morning.
You know, usually when I go home, but go back to the office, we TiVo the program every day, and then I just run it all day, you know, watch it. But sometimes I'll take a pause. I'll watch Varney once in a while and Cavuto later on in the day, stuff like that. And sometimes, rarely, but sometimes Cottle and Dagan, though, I don't watch that with the sound on because
right.
I've already heard all they have to say.
So. Yeah, it's better that way.
But they're pretty good. They're
thank
good.
You, Iman.
But I'm not going to be watching the Mensa meeting today, man.
No.
I actually watch the show, and I don't. Sometimes it has something to do with me, but not often. But it's funny. It's different. It's entertaining.
Mm-hmm.
And I like my attitude. I like my attitude.
Mm.
I know it sounds like I sound like an idiot.
You like your own attitude.
Yeah, I do. I like the attitude. I like the kind of guy I am. You know.
Well, I guess that's
that would be crucial.
That would be crucial. Exactly. Self love.
Then I was thinking about homosexuals last night.
And, as you so often do.
Does this have to do with self-love as well? Or?
No.
Okay.
But, you know, it should seem obvious. It's in light of the comments from the Duck Dynasty guy who's just an idiot.
Right, yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, you just... But, see, I don't know when I realized this. I guess a long time ago. About homosexuals. It sounds bigoted, but it's really not at all. But people love each other. Mm. So, and the sweetest thing you can see that I have seen in a long time was I was down to Huntsville, Texas at the Holiday Inn. Express.
Because that's how you roll.
Yeah. And these two women, they got to be, I don't know, you know, 50s, maybe, lesbians. And I see them all the time. I haven't seen them in a while because I'll stay someplace else now. But they let me keep my dogs. But I got to be on a sort of not friendly with them. Well, yeah, I can talk to them. And you could tell how much they loved each other. Now, and it didn't have anything to do with sex. Mm-hmm. In other words, I wasn't looking at them thinking,
right,
their neck could roll around, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
It was they had somebody, so they weren't alone. So then, like, you know, this time of year, people get, you know how people get. And so these two women, they got dogs and a bunch of other stuff, you know. So they have a life and a home, and they have each other. And like Bill White and his, Brian, I don't talk to Bill much because you can't trust him, but it doesn't mean he's, but he and Brian, they genuinely love each other.
Right.
And they've been out to the ranch a couple of times, and you see that. So it always surprises me. I know I'm a little naive, but it always surprises me when somebody's against that. So what does that have to do with your life?
Right.
It doesn't. You should worry about you being happy in your life, and you should be happy that these people are happy in their life. That's all.
That's right.
And if you don't think it's right, that's not up for you to decide. Don't worry about that. That's none of your business. It doesn't affect you. There's too many lonely people. Yeah. Too many lonely, unhappy people. Look at this guy and his dog.
Yeah.
Come on, man.
Yep.
I mean, it's not preaching at you here, but
no, you're right.
Preach, don't know how you ought to think about anything.
Preach, brother.
But that's how I think about it.
Here you go.
Yes, John.
Amen.
9 minutes after the hour, I just
praise God.
Still bummed out over that whole Mensa thing.
Yes, John.
Don't let it get you down, I mean.
Yeah.
Don't let it get you down. Thank you, Carly. Yeah. See, there you go. Some fresh coffee, I'm in.
You think I'm a professional?
Hey,
I'm a fighter.
All right.
Yeah. Won all these Marconis and every Hall of Fame you could be in and everything. And
every Hall of Fame.
Put something like that on the air, and you didn't help at all.
Cooperstown.
Let me just so I understand this.
Yeah.
I'm in the back. You say, where's Santa?
Right.
Bring Santa out here.
Yeah, I thought it would be
so
good
we
idea.
Can do the Mensa meeting.
Yeah.
And I'll come out here. Yeah. You know, I'll come out and I'll sit down.
Yeah.
You don't even acknowledge that I came out and sat down.
That's how we did. Well, I did.
No.
Yeah, like it's normal if Santa's here.
Yeah, it's just normal to have me sitting there mute.
Silence.
Hey, by the way, how's Mrs. Claus?
Oh, man, that's a nightmare, man. That's a nightmare. Menopause.
Oh.
Yeah, man, menopause.
Mrs. Claus got menopause.
Mrs. Claus got the menopause. And I'm sitting around every day, man. Is it hot in here to you? No, bitch, we at the North Pole. What's wrong with you? It's the North Pole. Close the window. You know? That's why I can't wait for, the 24th, man. I got to get out of the house, man. I can't take it no more. Yeah, man.
What's coming up in business is digging?
It's the North Pole.
If you were shopping at Target over Black Friday and the Thanksgiving weekend, your credit card number just might have been stolen.
Are you irritated with us about something? Or?
No. I'm just trying to sell the news and why it's important. Oh, no. Christmas spirit, baby.
Yeah.
Can I sit in your lap?
No, you can't sit in my lap.
Mine. Please come over, girl.
Easy, Santa.
But there are a bunch of other people around the building would like you to do that. I can tell you that now.
Yes.
You know, Deirdre ran into a couple of people yesterday who I make fun of on the program.
Well, this won't narrow it down. Will it? like Santa's list. Coming up. Yeah.
Like everybody in that room.
Okay, the whole sixth floor, you're out.
They don't like me, so they're mean to her.
That ain't right.
How's that make any sense?
That's wrong. That ain't
totally wrong.
See what you do to your poor wife.
I didn't do anything.
Yeah, I know, but then
like that moron Eric Bowling.
Oh, here you go.
I mean, I can't help it. that he's a moron. Now, how is that my fault?
How's this going? This is not going to help.
How's it? No, I'm curious.
Yeah.
Curious.
The Mensa meeting, the topic sucked. Right. I wasn't very good. That's my fault.
Oh, okay.
The fact that Eric Bolling is dumb, how is that my fault?
Anyone?
That's outside your parameter. Outside your domain.
Warner, how's that my fault?
Warner.
Huh?
Have a good time, Warner. Enjoy, Warner.
What, Warner?
I didn't say anything.
Oh, okay.
I think you ought to have a list of people that you haven't offended. That's what you want to say.
Yeah, well, I got to hear this.
Well, it'd be easier.
Look what people say about me. I don't get upset about it.
Well, clearly.
Anyway, what happened to sports last night?
Well, we had a good basketball game.
By the way, I'm kidding.
Oh.
I'm not serious about Eric Bolling or anybody else.
Just for the record.
He's not going to the Mets meeting, but he could have been at the one this morning.
After today.
He could have been there today.
Morning, Eric.
You had open auditions today.
Oh, man.
Open the door, Richard.
Anyway, what?
It was a good game.
Oh, yeah.
The Heat beat the Pacers, went down to the finish. That's what you want to see in the NBA.
All right, time for the news now at 13 after the hour. And here with that is Connell McShane. Good morning, Connell.
Hey, good morning, Iman. So the Senate approved the bipartisan budget deal 64-34. So that will, or 64-36 was the vote. So that helps us to avoid any kind of talk of a government shutdown. So you have that coming out of D.C. Another story here. I don't know if you heard about this spacewalk, but man, dangerous stuff up in space. It's going to happen over the weekend. But the backdrop of it, there'd be two American astronauts out there on the International Space Station. There was this astronaut who nearly drowned in his helmet back in July, Italian guy. So now NASA this time around has a plan to try to protect the crew as they head out into space. They're literally going to have like snorkels and absorbent towels. It's like snorkeling in case something goes wrong, like what happened to this Italian astronaut, where more than a gallon of water leaked into his helmet. So just filled up literally like a fishbowl, and it was almost just an absolute disaster. So they're trying to protect against that. The spacewalk will start tomorrow, go on for 3 days, the International Space Station. Hey.
Now, who wants to do that? Come on, man.
Let's hope the astronauts are right. Yeah, no, I know. Imagine that, the risk of, going out in space. So that's what they're doing this weekend. And Dennis Rodman, I'm in. He's back in North Korea.
How does this become part of the news? I'm curious.
I am just as curious in some ways. But, he works his way into the news because, who knows, maybe he solves our international problems, you know. Well, here's what he's going to do. He's planning to train some North Korean basketball players because... Well,
to do what?
Someone had to. Hopefully play basketball.
Oh, I see.
He spoke to reporters at the airport in Beijing before heading over. He expects to talk to his friend Kim Jong-un and make arrangements for an exhibition basketball game to be played in North Korea January 8th, which is Mr. Kim's birthday.
I hope this game brings a lot of countries together because, like I said, sports is so important to people around the world.
Yeah.
So
isn't that Elvis' birthday?
Engage American people, especially with Obama.
January 8th?
You know, just to try to talk to him.
Isn't it?
I think so.
Might be.
It's either Elvis's or Nixon's. Well, or perhaps both.
God, that's... We'll have to look up...
So we've only got about 9 million computers in this
Elvis's
building.
It's Elvis's birthday.
Give us a second.
It's Elvis. The dude was born on Elvis's birthday?
January 8th, 1935, Elvis was born. Yeah, you're right. Man, the I-Man's all over it. And Kim Jong-un.
That ain't right. Thank God Dwight Yoakam's okay. So
that's a good point.
Dwight Yoakam, the reason I got Dwight Yoakam's hat on is because he told me, I told him my guy at the man's hat shop in Albuquerque, Earl Stewart, I said, he can block any hat anytime. Dwight senses this. I don't worry, he senses. Right. He's got some special guy that says the only guy can do it. I said, my guy can do it overnight.
Done.
Stewart can at the man's hat shop, Central Avenue, Albuquerque.
To that.
So now what?
Yeah, now what?
So speaking of Dwight, thank God he's okay.
Man, that was something with the plane, the smoke.
Wow. I don't know if he owns that plane or not. I don't actually know him that well. I don't. Just enough to kind of be friendly with him. I love him to death, but thank God he's all right. So.
Yeah, it was a scary situation.
It's on a Hawker 8000, I mean, might have to upgrade a little.
Oh, so it's a takeaway from that, I guess. Hey, by the way, the Rodman thing, it's kind of funny, I think, that he's playing this exhibition basketball game. He says he's going to pick 12 basketball players to play in this game, and he's supposed to make the announcement. So
I mean, who's gonna play in the game? Which 12 players? Bring Bill Laimbeer back, or who's gonna play in this game in North Korea?
The Knicks.
With Rodman, yeah. That's right, Warner.
The Knicks.
Bargnani's going over there.
17 after the hour. Let's do sports in here with that.
Meta World Peace.
Sports all sponsored by Peerless Boilers.
Oh, he'd be there.
They make America's best boilers.
He's a good diplomat.
I didn't even know anybody else made boilers. Hey, by the way, I wanna mention, did you notice anything about Cindy Bigelow yesterday? She must be married, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's a good-looking girl.
Yeah.
You notice that?
Mm.
But they're a great, my God, what a great company. And they've been sponsors for years. That's nothing to do with anything. They, other than that, they produce 1.6 billion tea bags a year. And they package these American classic tea packages for the troops. They won't sell them.
Mm.
Guy tried to get one of them here yesterday. They're trying to scam this from the I-Man. Mm. Or from me. But they're sending millions of packs of this stuff to troops in Iraq and Afghanistan and wherever they are in the world. So
it's great.
Nice to have her in here.
Yeah.
That's pretty hardcore, too. She runs a pretty tight ship there.
Mm-hmm.
Great. It's a great company. And it's nice that they do that.
Mm.
But back to Peerless Boilers.
Right.
I called that guy one time, Pete Morgan. I said, need a water heater or something at the ranch or whatever it was. The cattle ranch out in New Mexico. And he gave it to us. Mm. They're a lot of money, you know.
He's right here, huh, man? He's waving at you.
Pete, how you doing, baby?
You can say hi, Pete.
Go ahead.
How you doing, baby? Doing great.
There you go.
Because that diet just didn't work, did it?
It's
probably better you didn't hear him.
And please. Your facelift didn't work either, brother. I love you, baby. Thanks, Warner. Ring the bell.
Oh, service ace.
Merry Christmas afternoon. That's a good one.
You too, my brother. We love you. Thank you.
All right, baby.
That was Merry Christmas.
That was good. Now, that's what we're looking for.
He walks out of the studio sipping coffee now.
Yeah, man, that's right.
Whoa.
He's got a cigarette.
Drop the mic.
What else you got to say, I man?
Yeah. Pete Morgan.
All right, what else, Warner?
All right, here we go. So the Heat, trailing the Pacers by 15 in the third quarter, came back, and they win it 97-92. But with the score 97-94 Heat, 3 seconds left, Paul George had a chance to tie the game.
Yeah.
Here was our old friend Mike Breen on ESPN.
Who will bring it up? Looking for George. George puts up a three. Off the mark. Anderson the rebound, and that'll do it. Miami with the come-from-behind win. George thought he was hit on that final shot. No whistle. And Miami with a thrilling turnaround here in the fourth quarter to even up the season series between these two rivals.
You know, Breen will be here tomorrow.
Oh, that's great.
And an addition of Vinny from Queens with Warner Wolf, Guns.
Oh, man.
Tony Powell and Lou Ruffino. Ooh. And Mike Breen.
Maybe
what else, Warner?
Maybe it'll be as good as the Mensa meet.
Let's hope.
No, and also in Milwaukee, now the Knicks beat the Bucks in double overtime.
You know, I got hammered by Varney.
Right.
I got my ass handed to me by Pete Morgan.
Oh, man.
And now you, Warner?
No, you know.
Saying right.
No, I love you, I'm man. Come on, dog. The bizarre situation. At the end of the first overtime, the Knicks were up by 2, just 14 seconds left in the game.
Now,
they had the 24 shot clock reset because of an offensive rebound.
Just hold the ball.
That's it.
No.
Or get fouled and make your foul shot.
Right.
So, but Andre Bargnani inexplicably decided to throw up a three-pointer.
What?
Here were the perplexed announcers, Spiro Dedis and Clyde Frazier of MSG.
Anthony, one-on-one with Antetokounmpo, shoots over 2. Offensive rebound, Chandler to Bargnani. What is he doing? What is he doing, folks? Why would he shoot the ball? Why? The Knick bench absolutely stunned, and Bargnani, for reasons only known to him, took the three.
I love the announcer. Who is that?
That's Spiro Dedis.
That's pretty good, Spiro. Yeah.
Used to be at FAN.
Wow. Yeah. 21 after the hour. What else?
Well, he was. real quick, Bargnani was asked why he took the ill-advised foul shot, three-pointer.
I was aggressive, and there was definitely a mistake.
He was aggressive.
He was aggressive and what?
And it was a mistake.
Well, that's okay.
That's okay.
No, it's not. No, sure, it's fine.
Gotta use your head.
Well, I understand, but everybody, you know.
This is a classic. It really is.
Like Chris Webber when he called timeout in Michigan State. Remember that?
That's right. Yep. Had no timeouts.
I mean, come on. You got to cut the guy some slack.
Yeah, that's right.
22 after the hour. Bernie's on his way back over to the
Christmas
ABC studios. Oh, we'll work all that out. Leif Babin and his partner, Jocko Willink, are coming up, and they've got a great company, Echelon Front LLD or whatever, something like that. And I'm going to get him to tell us about it. Also talk to him about Marcus Luttrell, that other stuff, in the movie Lone Survivor. So a couple of real American heroes next here on the Iverson. Well, Rob and Tony, I said, you know, I have a problem with L's.
Yeah.
With the letter L and saying them. Like, I can't say regularly.
No, that's a horrible word.
Stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so when I'm trying to pronounce Jocko Willink's name, was that right?
Nope. No.
What is it?
Willink.
Willink.
Mm-hmm. There you go.
There you go.
For the emphasis, was that right, Dagan?
Willink.
Willink.
Like I-N, you keep saying ick, and it's ink. It's Willink.
Your natural tendency is to go to Willink, but it's Willink.
Willink.
Yeah.
That's it.
Is that it?
That's
yeah.
it.
You got it. You
Jocko
got it.
Willink.
There you go.
Right, nobody mess him up. He's
got it.
Is the emphasis on the will part? Willink?
I do not. I do not know.
Willink.
That you can ask him.
Excellent idea.
I would go with Mr.
He's in the green room.
Two Navy SEALs.
Yeah, what could go?
Sir would work.
Sir.
Right.
Mr. is good.
What could possibly
go
wrong?
Got a company called Echelon Front that Leif Babin has told us a lot about.
Sure.
So, well, we called him Leif for a long time.
That went well.
Regularly.
I'm for a Bernie briefing.
Regularly, yeah.
Brief one, and sponsored by MyPillow. Good morning, B.
Morning, boss. Two winning tickets in the Mega Millions lotteries sold, and the winners came forth. One in California, one in Atlanta. California, the seller. The seller gets $1 million. In Atlanta, Georgia, the seller gets nothing. CNN did an interview. Listen to Jimmy Kimmel from last night.
The winner from Georgia bought her ticket at the Gateway Newsstand in the Buckhead neighborhood of Atlanta. CNN's Martin Savage went to that newsstand this morning, interviewed the owner of the store. Now, in California, the owner of the store that sells the winning ticket gets $1 million, but in Georgia, they get nothing. They used to get $25,000, but now they don't even get that anymore. Unfortunately, Mr. Savage was unaware of that fact, and this happened.
Now, you know, by selling the winning ticket, there's also prize money for you.
I know that this. I don't know how much. Long time ago, I heard it's $25,000.
$25,000. Let me just tell you, it's a lot more than $25,000.
Really?
It is about $1 million that you get.
Oh my gosh! Oh my God! I never had this. That's my.
Yeah, and you still don't, unfortunately. That is terrible. CNN should have to pay her $1 million, right?
Yeah, they should.
She should at least get an Anderson Cooper tote bag. There need to be some reparations.
Oh, that ain't right. Most until they are. Leif and Jocko.
As I did, and your reaction to my comments was much different, wasn't it?
Well, I'm not going to say anything to him.
Well,
what, do you think I'm crazy?
Oh, my God.
Please welcome to the Iverson of Marine Program, Leif Babin and Jocko Willink. Is that right?
Pretty close.
Pretty close.
Yeah.
Well, I have a problem with L's, so. Anyway, first of all, thank you both for your marvelous service to this country, and God bless both of you. Merry Christmas, Happy New Year, all that.
Thank you, man. Thanks for having us.
Oh, you're quite welcome. So, last time we talked, you were explaining to me what you do with Echelon Front, and I thought I'd have you guys back again, and you both could tell me about it, so tell me about it. Let's start with you.
Yes, sir. Echelon Front is a company we started about 2 years ago now. And we talk about how we train, build, and lead high-performance winning teams and the SEAL teams, and how that translates to the business world or any organization. And Jocko retired a few months before me. I got out of the service, left active duty about 6 months later, and we decided to form this company.
How long were you in, Jocko?
I was in for 20 years.
Oh, you were?
Yep.
Were you a SEAL all the time? Or?
Yeah.
Oh,
yep.
You were?
Yep.
And then how did you two hook up?
Actually, we were at SEAL Team 3 together, and deployed to Iraq, and that's where we met. That's where we became friends.
So, were you on missions together?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Absolutely. Jocko was my immediate boss. I was a platoon commander. He was my task unit commander.
Okay. Do you guys know this Marcus Luttrell? Do you know him?
Yes, sir. We do. He's a great guy.
Did you see the thing on 60 Minutes?
I actually did not see it.
Have you seen
it? I did. I saw it.
What'd you think?
Marcus is very open and honest about that, and he's been through, you know, having lost guys in combat. We lost two of our guys killed, one guy severely wounded that later died of wounds, and I know how horrific that is to deal with. And so, you know, I think some of his comments there, it's hard to understand the context that they're said. You know, I think Marcus is, he was just being kind of brutally honest about how he felt, you know, in the worst situation you could possibly be in. I think Marcus is a tremendous warrior and a true hero. And there are a lot of people that would have given up and not survived in that situation, and he did not.
I was talking to a guy yesterday, Peter Berg, who developed them, who directed the movie Lone Survivor, which is based on Mr. Luttrell's book. And he talked about how Marcus had lived with him. I guess it's been going on for years, him talking about doing the book, you know. And that he was pretty, not fragile, but he was pretty shaky there for a while, you know. And then he just got married, found a pretty good woman. And
his wife is amazing. And it's been great to get to know her. They were very close friends with Chris Kyle's family, you know, who was...
we had Chris on. Pretty interesting dude, you know. But the reason I ask you what you thought is because Marcus talked about when his buddy was screaming his name and he laid his rifle down and put his hand over his ears, and he described that act as cowardly, and I thought it was anything but that, but that's just me. I played the bugle in the Marine Corps, so what do I know? So
I can tell you Marcus is anything but a coward. And, yeah. I don't know if you know this, but when he got done with that deployment where he lost all of his friends and buddies, he actually deployed again to Iraq. I mean, into a hot combat zone. So, yeah.
He was with the SEAL team that relieved us in the city of Ar-Ramadi, which was in Iraq at the time in 2006, was the most dangerous place around. So he came right back into that just a year after that.
Well, I didn't express myself very well. What I took from that was that I felt bad that he felt that way. Because he was anything but that, as you just pointed out.
And I felt the same way. I mean, when I saw that interview, it was hard to watch, and it was unfortunate that CNN or Anderson Cooper really didn't in that interview did not really expand upon what that meant, and there was no context in the 60 Minutes piece of what that was about. And I think, you know, you're talking about someone being in the worst case situation, and he was in a position where he couldn't help his friend. And there really wasn't a whole lot else he could do. It was anything but cowardly. And I think, you know, a guy like Anderson Cooper is not going to understand what it's like to be in a situation like that.
We're talking with Leif Babin and Jocko Willink, and their company is called Echelon Front. And they, if you've got a company, you can call them. So when these companies call you and you apply the SEAL training, explain that to me. Explain to me, Jocko, start with you. Well, you go into a company arranges a meeting, they get all their people in it. What do you tell them?
Well, it's interesting because the same issues that you have when you're in combat, what you're trying to do is get people to accomplish a mission.
Right.
And you might think that every SEAL or every military guy is like a robot and they'll just listen to whatever you say and they follow orders. It's not true. You need to motivate them. You need to inspire them. And you need to kind of explain to them why we're doing what we're doing. And the same problems and issues that you have in combat when you're leading troops, they happen in every company in the world, and so we just lay out what we learned when we were overseas, when we were in combat, and we lay it out and how it can help them.
And it's important. You were talking, Leif, last time you were on, about how important it is the kind of person you hire as opposed to experience. Tell me a little bit about that.
Absolutely. I think so many people are focused on I need someone with experience in a particular field. Well, that doesn't necessarily mean good experience. And so that's a very short-term focus when you're looking at, I don't want to have to train this person over the next few weeks or months, whereas someone who is just highly motivated, they're driven, what we call aggressive in the military, but they're focused, they're disciplined, they take ownership of problems. Those are the kind of people that you can train them to do just about anything, and they'll quickly surpass someone with even years of experience.
So do you encourage companies then to evaluate who they have? And if they don't have motivated people or people like that, then to hire new people? Is that or can you salvage people who are, you know?
I think you can always make people better, but there's also some people that won't ever change, and they won't ever learn, and they won't ever get any better, so you got to get rid of them.
What's the response from some of these companies?
We've had outstanding response. We've really been working with a series of companies over the long term for 9 to 12 month training programs, and we've seen some outstanding. It just increased in teamwork, folks actually working together that weren't doing so before, and the company's very successful.
You know, I know somebody here, in fact, you guys gave a presentation here at Fox, right?
We did.
Somebody saw that and said it was like nothing they'd ever seen in their life. So I haven't noticed any changes around here, but they run a pretty – this is a pretty well-run place. Like I've worked at all of the networks over the years, and the thing I noticed about from the door on in – like the security here is never, it never changes. I've been walking in the door for 4 years. There's never been a screw up. They're all former cops, military guys too. So, but you know, you walk through the halls, there's not a bunch of rooms with junk sitting in it. People, you know what I'm saying? So it's a pretty tight ship they run. So it's kind of curious as to what they'll take out of that meeting, but it'd be interesting to see. So.
Yes, sir. There's no question. It's a great organization. We are very proud to be a part of it in a small way, and we had received some outstanding feedback from them.
Yeah, and I think what happens too is an organization that's doing great. Why are they doing great? It's because they set high standards for themselves, and they're always looking for a way to improve, even more. So that's what they're doing, looking what little things can they do better.
Well, they let you know what they expect, and then they follow up. You know, they don't tell you things are going to be a certain way. I tell the kids, we have a ranch for kids with cancer out in New Mexico, and I tell every group of them, I say, most people you meet in life are full of it. And they tell you they're going to do something, they never do it. I say, how many of you kids have had people tell you they're going to do something? Well, they all raise their hands from their parents on down. So nobody follows up. Nobody. That's not the case here. So.
That I think that follow-up is key. And when Jocko taught me this concept that we now call extreme ownership. And it's when you're setting high standards for a team, so many people don't do that follow-up, as you say, my man. And we talk about that as in that it's not what you preach, it's what you tolerate. And so if you're, which is, I think that really captures what you're talking about. If you say, I expect you to do this, this, and this, but then there's never any consequences, no one's held accountable, there's no one saying you're responsible for what didn't happen or substandard performance, then you've just set a new standard, which is you're cleared hot to underperform for the rest of the team.
What's the current situation in Iraq and Afghanistan, speaking of that? What's going on there?
It's Iraq is having some issues right now, very, very violent place. And we expected that with the U.S. pullout, that there was going to be some spike in violence. I think between the Shiite government has really kind of encouraged this to happen by really kind of cracking down on the Sunnis and excluding them from the government. Wow. And because they were the majority that was suppressed for so long under Saddam Hussein. And so some of the big victories that we were a part of in Ramadi and the Anbar Awakening and these Sunni militias that were formed were disbanded, and many of those guys have kind of gone back to an insurgency, and I think Syria next door obviously is causing a lot of problems as well.
We're worse off there now. Are they worse off than they were under Saddam?
Or when? I definitely think they're better off now than under Saddam, for sure.
How about Afghanistan? Tough, huh?
It's tough. It's tough. I always say it's about will. That comes down to a contest of wills. And do we have the will as a nation to win? And if we have it, then we will. If we don't, then, we won't.
Well, I don't get the feeling we do. I mean, from the White House on down, so.
There's no question.
Not to pick on him. He's fine. But, I'm just saying. You just don't get that feeling, so.
We definitely, we've got some struggles there. And he talked to combat troops coming home right now. They're very frustrated. And they feel like the will is gone. And the enemy knows that. And they're moving back in.
So how does somebody who has a company get a hold of you guys?
They go to our website, echelonfront.com, echelonfront.com. And they can email us, and we'll reach back out to them. And we come in, do an assessment, talk about their particular challenges and their teams and their goals, the mission they're trying to accomplish, and then how we can help.
So I have a few things offer, other than people laughing at what is my pillow deal. Because I've sold over a million people. This guy, Jocko's looking at me like I lost my mind. But this guy developed a pillow that's revolutionary. But your company is one of the few things I've heard in a long time that makes a lot of sense. So I can't imagine you're going to be enormously successful. Anyway, Merry Christmas. Happy New Year. Thank you both.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Jocko, nice to meet you.
Good meeting you, too.
Let me know until the end. Fox News Building. We're at the corner of 48th and 6th Avenue of the Americas here in right in the middle of New York City. They have the Fox and Fiends people have they're just so stupid. What? They have a live nativity scene.
Oh, yeah.
And so what we need now is O'Reilly to come storming onto the set and say, no, no, this is not the way this happened.
That's not how it was.
And that's not what Jesus did.
Who brought that camel in here?
We don't know what Jesus said. We don't even know if we're rocking any baby.
This is not what the factor wants.
It was a fat guy in a chef's hat. He wasn't there. So I'm down with Teresa this morning. She was trying to do something with my hair.
Yeah.
And she says to me, where are we going with this? what do you mean? So where are we going?
What's
with
the point?
What are you doing with...
A long-term plan.
So what's a long-term plan for your hair? How the hell do I know?
That's a great question. Yeah.
She said, "Well, are we going yeah. to a Willie Nelson thing with braids?"
Yeah, just so she knows.
I said, "No."
Give me a mission statement on this, would you please? I could deal with anything.
I'm just letting it grow. I'm just letting it grow. That's all. She said, "Well, I can tell you where it's going."
Where would that be?
Yeah, where are we going?
And then she dissed Hanson, who cuts my hair and has been for years.
Oh.
Hanson used to be with it, Fred Fakai, and now she's, I don't know what she's at some other place. But So she's leaving me to believe that she thinks Hanson doesn't know how to cut hair, but Hanson does know how to cut hair. So, but Teresa dissed her. So.
Good.
That's where we are. That's
mm-hmm.
Is James going to be stuffing your turkey in that special, unique way?
You know, I think you're getting more immature.
Yeah. Really?
Age. Yes, I think you're regressing. I think you're sort of... were you mature when you were a teenage boy?
No.
Hey, James, hang on a second. I just want to know... Here, why don't you ask him that, Mr. Simon?
I'll be happy to.
Good morning, sir. What do you want to know?
Hi, James. How are you? Oh, I asked her if you were going to be stuffing her turkey in that special, unique way.
Well, at my age, I'm happy to stuff any turkey.
Gobble, gobble.
Happy Thanksgiving, all of you.
Happy Thanksgiving, James.
He's making that up. He can stuff with the best of them.
I'll bet.
He's never lost any of his stuffing ability.
No. If I ask a question,
right.
Let me talk.
Name one thing I was mean with her about.
No, just your attitude.
Anyway.
Just say, well, I can't believe how dumb you are.
You've done that
to me,
too.
I'll tell you how goddamn dumb I am. No. I got $100 million in the bank. How dumb is that?
Guess what?
Yeah,
I can
dummy.
Name a lot of people that make a lot of
I'm
money.
I'm so dumb.
And they wouldn't even bring in the potato salad to the Mensa picnic, so. Potato
salad. What?
Speaking of potatoes, Lise.
Potatoes. I mean, the idea that you would say that if it's not organic, it's not food.
Your idea of an argument is to insult a person.
No, no.
Rather than to argue on the merits.
On the facts, exactly.
Yes.
I'm
talking about the facts
no, no,
all
no.
the time.
Because
she
when,
had the
no, 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 no. When you insult...
You just,
no,
well,
no,
you
no.
just said...
Let
you didn't understand what I said about potatoes.
When
just because
insult,
they're not organic doesn't make them not a food.
Somebody,
that's not what I said.
When you insult somebody, you lose the argument. You know why?
Yes.
Because it shows you,
right.
that you don't have
yeah,
the facts and the evidence
right.
on your side.
That's not true. It shows I got under your skin and you can't stand it, so now you're trying to compensate sitting
no.
here, and so are you.
Who's doing the compensating?
You spend your whole life compensating
the person who's doing
hours
the
after
the
I've said something to you.
The person who's doing the compensating is the one that's trying to talk
poor,
over the other person.
That poor little Lisa is not that bright anyway, and so you take advantage of that by bludgeoning her like a baby seal.
Yeah, that Harvard
it's
law
not pretty to
just,
watch.
Just really doesn't
Just
help
because you're a lot smarter than she is, you don't have to lord it over all the time.
But... Imus in the morning.
Coming up, Stuart Varney. And I refuse to put you through that Mensa meeting again.
Oh. Hey, what's going on?
Well, our boss is here.
Hey, Kevin?
Kevin McGee, he was who runs the Fox Business Network. He just brought me a present.
I hope this doesn't blow up, huh?
You better have that checked.
It's a jug of Gillette Fusion Gel
right.
and a razor. You know, here's the thing. That's very nice of him, first of all.
Merry Christmas, Kevin.
But I need it because I, in my little travel thing, I needed one about this size.
There you go.
That's pretty cool, isn't it?
It's a thoughtful Christmas.
Does he mean he wants me to shave now, like for tomorrow's show?
Yeah.
I
did. Cut your wrist.
One of the better people on the planet to work for, by the way, him, Kevin McGee. So we were talking about Jocko and Leif Babin.
Right.
Jocko makes Leif look like a Boy Scout.
Yeah, that's the dude you want coming through the door.
But, you know, the way Jocko looks at you when you're talking to him, you better not be full of.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, he seemed especially impressed by the My Pillow comments you were making.
Well, I had a good point.
You know you did.
It sounds stupid and frivolous, but it's not. One of the best ideas in a long time is that crackhead who developed that MyPillow.
Yeah.
Mm. You may think it's stupid, but that's not.
Mm-mm.
It's really revolutionary. And the company that these two guys have, I mean, I'm not stupid. And I just think it's the smartest, most revolutionary management approach since Jack Welch's Six Sigma, whatever he called it. He didn't have his hands all over everybody, every woman in Fairfield County. Remember that? He used to call Jack Wells Jack the Zipper. Remember that, Bernie?
We all stray.
Yeah. So. No, I just think it's enormously impressive what they do and how they can help your company. And I think about like say you got a big car dealership and you got a bunch of salesmen and some are good, some are, I mean, I'm just using that as an example. You could call Jocko and Leif at echelonfront.com. Is that the website?
I believe so.
We'll find out what it is so I don't give the wrong information.
That's exactly what I'm doing here. I believe it is.
Have them come out and...
Yep, echelonfront.com. You're right.
Come out and talk to your folks and sell probably twice as many cars. And that's not an exaggeration. So.
Yep.
And two American heroes, too, by the way. Not two fake-a-loo jerks, you know, two Wall Street, well, that's some of my friends there, but not two sleazebags.
Right.
Two real American heroes, you know? So that's why I had them back on.
Yep.
It's 8 minutes after the hour, so. But they're the real deal. And Santa, did you get to meet them?
Oh, yeah. I had them up at the North Pole.
Oh, you did?
Yeah. They work with the elves.
Yeah.
I had to get rid of a few of them elves, man.
What?
I had to get rid of some elves. They was plotting on me, that's why.
Oh.
See, that's the thing they'll uncover.
Yeah, man. The last thing you want is some little people.
little sneaky elves.
Yeah, man, plotting on you, man. Ain't I am talking behind my back. I know what's going on.
Sure.
You know, so I had to bring them on up there.
So will you be visiting people here at Fox?
Oh, there's a couple I'd like to visit. Yes, sir.
What time does O'Reilly get in, Bernie? Do you know?
Different times, different days.
I could arrange for you to see him. I'm friends with him.
Oh, I'd love to talk to him.
Yeah. And Megan Kelly, she's a friend of mine.
Yeah?
Her husband. I'm about closer to him than her. I mean, I know him better than her, sort of.
Oh, okay.
Maybe she'd like to meet you.
I'm sure she would. Is she a believer?
Does she believe in Santa Claus?
Yeah.
Of course she does.
Oh, well, this is beautiful then.
Everybody believes in Santa Claus.
Well, there you go.
If you can find out what she wants for Christmas.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I already know what she wants for Christmas. I just got to see if I can get enough vitamin E.
Dagan Madel, did I forget the business report with you last time?
Yes, sir.
Why don't you tell me that when I do that?
Really?
Yeah.
Because I'm sitting here, and I've got a lot of things on my mind.
Clearly.
And I apologize for that. I didn't mean to.
Sometimes we all just have to let things go. Just let it, you know. We're here now.
Because, see, sometimes when I say, hey, Dagan, what's coming up, then that sounds to me like a business report.
Right.
Mm. Yeah.
So I'm just wondering if we should do it now.
I can do it now for one reason, because my business story is actually probably one of your biggest news stories of the day.
Oh. All right.
All right, I'll tell you what it is. Up to 40 million credit card and debit card numbers were stolen at Target stores over Black Friday weekend. That's right. So if you were shopping at Target, you better look out, because your credit card information, that means your name and even that security code on the card, could have been compromised. The theft is national in scope, not online. basically these machines at the registers got tampered with. That's what we know so far. The Secret Service is investigating, but you better watch your credit card statements.
You know, I was going to stop by the drugstore. I go to Thomas Drugs or sometimes Eisner Chemist over there. If I want to pay twice as much for whatever I buy, at a drugstore, I go to Eisner Chemist. If I want to pay regular price, I go to Thomas Drugs. So, with my two favorite haunts in the city. I was going to stop by and get me a travel size of, you know, shave yourself, take with me to Texas. So that means that Mr. McGee, my boss, actually went someplace and bought this this morning, didn't it?
Yes. Very, very thoughtful. I mean, that's very nice.
It's a kind of, I don't know what the razor is. The razor, I don't think I'm going to be able to use that. So.
Yeah. You can shave now.
Test it out on you.
What's coming up in sports, Warner?
Well, we had this really a fine game. You know, it's only here we are in December, and it was a you know like a playoff game.
Sure.
Miami Heat and the Indiana Pacers, two of the best teams in the NFL.
Passions were running high.
Yes, but the bizarre game of the day or night was the Knicks' Andrea Bargnani.
Yeah.
With the Knicks ahead by 2 points.
Did the Knicks win?
They did win in double overtime.
Well, okay, that's fine.
No thanks to him.
Right, well, he made a mistake.
And
we all make mistakes.
As you saw on the Fox Business News, when he threw up the 3-pointer.
I didn't see that. Did you run that footage?
Oh, yeah.
Hey, follow it up,
yes,
Bigfoot. Let me see that.
He did.
Here we go.
Well, here was. Let's hear the call first by Spiro Dietis and Clyde Frazier.
Anthony, one-on-one with Antetokounmpo, shoots over two. Offensive rebound, Chandler to Bargnani. What is he doing? What is he doing, folks? Why would he shoot the ball? Why?
The Knicks bench absolutely stunned, and Bargnani, for reasons only known to him, took the three.
And then what happened?
Well, the Bucks tied the score, so it had to go into a second overtime. But we asked, Bargnani was asked why he took the shot.
Yeah.
And here he was.
I was aggressive.
He was aggressive.
Well, no, you cut that off. You said it was a mistake.
Yeah.
So you're trying to make him look bad.
That's right.
Oh, yeah.
This is bad.
That's not good.
No.
Doctoring the tape.
13 after the hour. All right, Bernie, what do you got coming up?
I got Hillary Clinton, Dennis Rodman, and Ryan Seacrest.
Time for some news now. And here with that is Connell McShane. Morning, Connell.
Morning, Iman. To the NSA first, as President Obama's advisory panel is back with some recommendations saying there should be more oversight of NSA spying, and they say the collection of American phone records should be limited. Also, greater scrutiny of decisions to spy on leaders around the world who are friendly to us. So the White House conducting an overall intelligence review. The president expected to announce some sort of next steps come January. The story in New York, the U.S. attorney in New York saying that an Indian diplomat who was apparently strip-searched following her detention on visa charges was treated, in his words, very well and was even given coffee, allowed to make phone calls, become a big deal, especially in India. The U.S. attorney says...
Who strips, sir?
Well, he was taken in by State Department officials on these, as I said, visa charges. It basically was a nanny issue where she was... the documentation issues with one of the nannies she was using living here in New York, as Deputy Consul General for India. So they said that she was
pretty.
Treated the wrong... wasn't treated right when she was brought in. That was the case. Now, Preet Bharara, the U.S. attorney's coming out, said, no, we did it all by the book and, you know, offered her coffee and everything else. So it's become a huge deal in India. They're very upset
offered
about
her coffee?
This. That's what he said, yeah.
Well, why did strip search the girl?
Well, they said that's just what happens when people... He did say that happened.
What happens what?
When people are brought in on these charges, make sure they don't have anything with them, that you go through a search, and it was a female officer who searched her before she was detained, and that goes along with the territory, apparently.
What do you think, Bernie?
I think I would have liked to have strip searched her, but it would have been inappropriate is all I'm saying.
Yeah. And,
you know, keep your hands off the lady. Who this person who strip searched her, we need to know more about this woman.
Yeah, what's going on here?
Yeah.
But it's interesting.
That sounds fishy to me.
She looks like a Bollywood actress, this lady.
Yeah, what are you talking about?
Yeah, so.
And you're okay with this, Connell?
I'm okay with it. No,
sounds to me like you are.
Yeah. I don't have an opinion on it. You know me. We'll make it past.
Do you have any more news?
On the news. Oh, this Harvard story. A lawyer says a Harvard student accused of making that bomb threat the other day just to get out of a final exam was under a great deal of pressure. It now seems remorseful.
So much for that Harvard education lease.
Lease wheel. Federal public defender Ian Gold saying that the student Eldo Kim was also dealing with the third anniversary of his father's death.
Oh, wow. He's very remorseful. There's a statement in the complaint which you have where he confessed.
Yeah, so he was released on bond into the custody of his sister who lives in Massachusetts, so he feels bad about that.
I'm sure he does.
Yeah. Well, Russian President Vladimir Putin, we talked about the NSA earlier, he's coming to the defense of the spying program. He had a news conference over in Russia and says mass surveillance is needed to fight terrorism and also to expose terrorist contact. So he's kind of, you know, he's all in favor of it.
16 after the hour, time for some business news. And here with that is Dagan McDowell. Morning, Dagan.
I do have additional business news. I told you about that 40 million in credit card numbers that were stolen at Target. The futures are down 39 points because jobless claims jumped to the highest level since March at 379,000. So we don't like to see that. And that's it.
All right. Thanks, Dagan. 16 after the hour. A conversation with Paul, with Stuart Varney coming up. But before we get to that, it's time for sports, and that's sponsored by Peerless Spoilers. And here with sports is Warner Wolf. Morning, Warner.
Morning, Iman. You remember Southern Illinois coach Barry Hinson? Remember, he was openly critical. We heard him of his team after Tuesday night's loss to Murray State.
You got to talk about his wife and all that.
That's right.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, his wife could shoot better than these guys. Well, here was Hinson yesterday with a message for those who criticized him.
I stand by, and I believed every word I said. And if that ruffles your feathers or ruffles somebody else's feathers, then you know what? You're going to have to deal with it.
Oh.
Good.
Damn. How about that? Don't mess around with it.
Deal with it.
That's right.
I liked that response because he didn't say anything that was particularly out of line. So.
No. A little unusual.
Well, it's fine.
Yeah. And this is interesting. Here is Christmas time, and you know, you have to buy presents and things.
You're
not every
true, Warner.
Oh, sure.
Oh, okay. Go ahead.
Of course. Not everybody wants to play for the Yankees. Here was free agent right fielder Shin Soo Chu. Remember his brother Chu?
No.
He has turned down the Yankees' offer of $140 million for 7 years, an average of $20 million per year. I mean, here's a guy.
Turn him down. What's he going to do?
He thinks he's going to do better.
Oh.
But, I mean, he's a 285 lifetime hitter, averages only 20 homers and 80 RBIs a season. What's he thinking? I don't know. And the Clippers beat the Pelicans last night.
And the Mets meeting was bad enough.
With their cousin,
Achoo. Achoo. Only does.
God bless you.
God bless.
Did you know?
I promise you, Vinny from Queens will be good tomorrow.
That's it.
13 after the hour. Varney is next.